Good morning, everyone. Welcome to EduSat Network. Hope you all are doing great. Today's topic is Feminist Theory and Perspective, and the expert will be looking at and also discussing the three waves of feminism. For discussion on the same, we have with us in the studio Dr. Aprajita Kashyap, who is an assistant professor, University School of Law and Legal Studies, Guru Gobind Singh, Indraprastha University. I would also like to share with you all that she holds a PhD from Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. Welcome, ma'am.
Yeah.
Thank you for being with us.
Yes. And should I begin with my?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. Okay. So today's discussion is on feminism, and I would be basically looking at feminist theory, and I would also be tracing the development through the three waves. And before I begin, I would just like to introduce the topic by giving certain aspects and notions which has made feminism an important field in all theories and praxis. Now, if as we have developed this theory or notion of feminism, there has been a critical dialogue, and it has feminism is a concept which has always questioned the mainstream philosophical theories or political theories, because there was, in the earlier days, there was hardly any mention of women as a different identity in any of the upheld theories. So this was some of the things which were glaring, and that is why feminism as a separate stream emerged. Now, if we look at the dialogue of feminism, there are four important aspects which occur if we talk about gender per se. So gender or the female gender has four aspects. One is a personal identity, a social identity, a power relation, and a mobilized political identity. And this mobilized political identity is because of the efforts of the women themselves. Now, as we all know, that prejudice based on gender has been deep rooted in all cultures. It is not that it's either the Indian culture or the Muslim culture which discriminates on the basis of gender. It had been deep rooted in many of the Western culture as well. For example, if we look at the voting rights, Europe was very late in giving voting rights to women. So it's the degree may differ, the kind may differ, but the bias or prejudice based on gender had always been present if we look at many of the standing or existing theories. Now, before we begin with, I'd like to share some facts and why the discussion on feminism becomes important. If we look at the existing arguments or the existing facts, we know that men and women are different. They are different biologically. They are different physically, but fundamentally, if we look at them, there should be no difference, but this is not the fact. Now, if we look at the economic strength of women, we see that they possess only 1% of the land. Then a third thing that we see is that these are the disadvantages of development. And we look at some of the negative aspects, that is 80% of refugees around the world are women. And you know, their contribution cannot be negated, because they are the ones who are producing 80 to 95% of food in the poor regions. And if we look at the political strength that they have gained throughout these years, we see that only 25 women had been elected as heads of states in the various almost 194 states that we have. And one thing which is very important and which would be the basis of today's discussion is that they had always or more or less been absent in mainstream political theories. So on this premise then, because of these facts, we know that there had been discrimination amongst women, and discrimination were of these kinds. Now, for example, when I looked at the rubrics of feminism and the four aspects that I said, and these four aspects became important because there had been discrimination. And if we look at the discrimination, some of them have been highlighted. They could not own property. They were denied voting rights. They could not bring suit or sign contracts. They were denied position of leadership. The married women assumed the husband's surname. And there were always unequal pay for equal jobs. Women were being paid less for the same kind of job that the men were doing. So these were some of the important things which said that there is a need to empower women or to look at them differently. Now, if we look at the needs of the women's empowerment and how to bring them into mainstream politics and how to bring them about and give them some justice, we needed to end gender inequality. We needed to liberate them from the artificial historical restraints. We needed to lessen the strain in the constraint, in the conditions of the family. The women were supposed to do the tough tasks of the family. They were supposed to be the bread givers, bread providers of the family. They were supposed to look after the children. And so much so that the first and foremost role of the women became within the confines of the four walls of a house, and they were not supposed to be contributing economically. And that is why whatever their contributions, and we still ignore the contributions of women in the GDP in many of the countries. So this had to go. Then we needed to change the worldview that women were not the second class citizens. They were more than that. So all these said that we have to highlight women's identity. Women were not something which we could take for granted. They had to have an identity of their own. So if we look at the identity of women, and I would be tracing the lecture in these structure, I would be structuring my lecture on these bases. The first is, how did women stand in the opinion of philosophers throughout the political history? What were the women's movements that contributed to women becoming significant actors in politics? What is the concept of feminism? What are the social issues that we talk about? Some of the social issues are equal rights for women, freedom of decision in terms of career or in terms of marriage or in terms of the size of the family. These became very important. But we should not forget that wherever we are discussing women, the entire premise or the entire argument began on the divide between public and political life. And when I quote Aristotle, this would become clear. Now, let us begin by introducing what is feminism. So if we look at feminism, the concept of feminism, it is a belief in the social, political, and economic equality of the sexes. And the goal of feminism are, first goal is to determine the importance of women. Then the second goal is to reveal that historically women have been subordinate to men. And third is to bring about gender equity. You know, the term equality is not used here because equality would mean, equality means the same kind of status, but it is not possible given the physical limitations of women. So it is best to use the term gender equity. Now, if we look at the history of this concept of feminism, the term came into use in 1890 in English. The origins of the feminist movement began in the abolitionist movement of the 1830s. And if we somehow come to the contemporary concept of feminism, we can trace it to the 1960s. And why 1960s? Because these were some of the changes which were taking place in the status of family or in the aspirations of women. The first was that divorce became commonplace. Women were no more the happy housewife tag that they carried always. There were higher level employments for women also, opportunities for women started opening up, and fulfillment outside the home were becoming the norm. So we had the concept of career women who would not be the family providers or totally housewives. We had women looking for role beyond the realm of the household. So if we try to trace the development of the feminist movement, and if we look at, given the constraints, it is best to articulate a set of disjuncts. We cannot say that, because there is a lot of controversy about the term feminism per se. Everybody has a different opinion about what is feminism. And if we trace the background, it evidently becomes clear. The first was the Age of Enlightenment, when we talked about egalitarianism, we talked about liberal philosophies, reformist ideas, and the highlight of this Age of Enlightenment was that these ideas must be extended even to women. Then comes the 18th century, and Mary Wollstonecraft, she became the protagonist of this feminist movement because of her published work, A Vindication of the Rights of Women, in 1792. Now, before this, she had published another anonymous piece, which was called A Vindication of the Rights of Man. And Mary had gone through a crisis in her own family. She was the second among six siblings, and how her mother was tortured in the family, then how her sister got abused in a marriage. And all these led to her to develop her own notions of women's rights. And this is when she publishes this book. Now, 19th century, there were movements to abolish slavery. And you know why it is, why is this movement to abolish slavery being quoted here is because many of the times, for example, Aristotle would equate women with slaves. And therefore, the movement to abolish slavery, it was considered, would take care of the concept of providing equity to women. Then the temperance movement, the movement to get voting rights among the women, all these were some of the 19th century important developments. And then we move on to the early 20th century, and this is the time when feminist movement becomes deeply entrenched. But we have to keep in mind that feminist movement were more so importantly taking place in West, and that is US and Europe. But we cannot say for sure that India did not have rights given to women, because if we look at the history of India in the Vedic age, we see that women enjoyed a lot of power. Women were, for example, in the performance of yagyas, women had to be an important part. So we cannot for sure say that because India is a developing country and India was denigrating women to the secondary status. It wasn't so. In the early period, it was equal rights for women, but over the period we degenerated, especially during the colonial period, the Mughal rule, the colonial period. But then we have to think in these terms that India was ahead of many of the Western countries by providing voting rights to women. So if we look at now the early 20th century, it was dominated by the suffragette movement, mostly in Europe, because many of the European countries, they had criteria for getting voting rights, and one of the criteria was that women were not allowed voting in many of the countries. And Switzerland, for example, 1970s, it started providing voting rights to women. And 21st century was not about voting. It wasn't about equality in terms of the family status, or it wasn't in terms of employment. It was more about empowerment. So women started talking about empowerment and in terms of economic and political empowerment. So this is some of the developments that were taking place. Now, and this concept that feminism is a new theory does not hold good. But the fact that it was thrown open to the people, to the public at large, or it became the mainstream problem area, was because of certain movements that were taking place throughout the world. And I would like to just quote a couple of movements. And importantly, if we look at them, they are in the second half of the 20th century. For example, the National Organization for Women was started by Betty Friedman in 1966. Then we had another organization called Women's Organization for Equal Rights. Now, women started working in the professions which were earlier domains of men. So there were certain organizations within the employing agencies which were looking after the interest of the women. There were new types of jobs which were being created for women due to the growth of service sector. And there too, we had institutions or organizations which were defending women's rights. And to top it all then, we started declaring decades for women, and International Decade for Women was 1976 to 85. So a whole 10-year devoted to women's issue was one of the key factors in bringing feminist motives or feminist ideas to the fore. Then not only were there movements, we started crystallizing the movements, the demands or the wants, and we had concrete organizations then which started working for women's empowerment. We had the Women's Peace Party, which was founded in 1915, and this peace party now is called the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. One important thing was that we had political parties till now fighting on ideologies. So parties would be either a liberal party or a Christian Democrat party or a socialist party or a Marxist party. 1955 was a determining year when we had political parties which were taking or espousing the cause of women's empowerment. So this was the first one. Then we had Women's Action for Nuclear Disarmament. This was started in the 1980s, and it was mainly to oppose nuclear buildup during the Cold War. The Cold War was marked by heightened rivalry between United States and USSR, and both of them were trying to amass as much nuclear weapons as they could. And then we had started this concept that it was somebody had to bring down the level or the amount of nuclear arsenals, and the women took it up. And this was the WAND was one of the major organizations which was decrying the nuclear buildup. Then we had the 1995 Beijing conference sponsored by United Nations, and this was mainly on the status of women in the North and South, and this took up the aspect that the women in the North and South, how they are not equally empowered. Women in the North enjoy more equality, they enjoy a more superior status than the women in the South. And this 1995 was a determining year when we started talking beyond only women's issues. Because see, when we started, we began with men versus women. And now 1995 onwards, we start talking about women of the North versus women of the South. This becomes equally important in then a new stream of feminism which comes up. And this is called the neocolonialism or the postmodernist feminist movement. And I would be discussing it eventually. If you look at some of the political philosophers, Plato was one of the earliest exponents of gender equality. He was a feminist, we can say, because he said in his book Republic that women should be trained to rule. And can you imagine that a person like Plato, he deemed women fit to be even ruling at par with men. And Aristotle takes a U-turn. He says home is the rightful place, household chores do not give them enough time for political participation, and he even goes to the extent of equating women with slaves. Now, if you look at Rousseau, and ironically, Rousseau was the one who had inspired the French Revolution and giving the three concepts of liberty, fraternity, and equality. And he says, women are subversive to unity and order of the polity. He denied them citizenship rights, and he demanded that women be educated differently. So he practices something, and he preaches something else. Now, if you look at Kant, he talked of moral equality, but moral equality for him did not include women. Marx, for example, was silent on the role and position of women. J.S. Mill, if we look at him, he is the only mainstream philosopher to be espousing the cause of women by asking them to get enfranchised, or that is, to attain voting power. Other sympathizers were Henri Comte, Friedrich Engels, August Bebel. So all of them had positive things to say about the status of women. Now, if we'll come to the feminist movement, this was a background. If we come to the feminist movement, there are different demands, there are different theories, there are different movements which have arisen. And we just now come to the main core concept of feminism. What is feminism? the alternative name for feminism is Women's Liberation Movement, WLM in the modern terminology. The campaign is mostly to attain right for women and to look after the interest of the women. And if we just say it in plain and simple terms, it is about acquiring basic human rights for the women. It seeks equal political, social, sexual, intellectual, and economic rights for women as given to men. So they are not asking for anything extra. They are just asking for parity with the powers which men enjoy. The women should be able to enjoy those powers. And as I said in the, at the outset of the lecture, that I'm going to periodize the movement. So if we look at how political thinkers have periodized, they have periodized it in three waves: the first wave, second wave, and third wave. And then the most important era or period is the 1960s civil rights movement in US, and this was the provocation for women to fight for better social conditions. Now, this concept per se had different meanings in different periods, and that is why the periodization became important. For example, if we look at the mid-1800s, it meant qualities of women. 1892 was the Women's Conference in Paris. This was the defining year when we started using the term feminism in English vocabulary. Women's Conference in Paris, it advocated equal rights for women. They wanted to resist male domination. They wanted to teach women to see themselves as oppressed. And one extreme view was that the women made sure that they would blame the men and the patriarchal society for all their problems and all their stigma and all their backwardness. So they not only wanted equal status, they also wanted to blame the men for what they were or what their status were. So this, the last point, becomes very important in being now on the defensive, not only on the defensive front, but on the offensive front. So let us look at the first wave. What is the first wave? It is the wave which was prevalent during the 19th and the early 20th century and predominantly Western concept. The fight was for basic political rights or suffrage. This was known as the suffrage struggle. The basic civil and legal rights were demanded, that is, simple things like right to education. Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony of USA, they had published their work called Revolution, and this brought about a revolution in the feminist movement. Victoria Woodhull, she was nominated by the Equal Rights Party as the first women presidential candidate in 1872. So all these were happening in the first wave, and we see the outcome is that women have been recognized as an important part. The second wave was the next phase, and it waned between the two world wars. It revived in the late 1960s and early 1980s. So in addition to political rights, social and economic rights, fight for greater equality in education, in workplace, and at home were demanded. So it was not about just about political rights. There was social things which were being demanded, economic rights were being demanded. The women movements asked for removal of gender inequality and oppression. And there was the emergence of liberal, radical, and socialist stream within the feminist movement. So it wasn't now only feminist movement or women's right. We had different ideologies which were backing the feminist movement. Now the third wave is from 1990s to the present, and it says that there are differences even among women because of not their birth or any other aspect, but because of their race, their ethnicity, class, nationality, and religion. So this third wave attributes that the differences are also within the women themselves. So women as a group does not now hold good. In among the women also, then you have differences, and there are different kinds of movements to look after the interest of the different classes among the women. Gender struggle is due to the search of an identity, and This phase is marked by more recent expansion and transformation of feminism. So feminism now does not only include social, economic, political aspects, it also includes empowering the women. So there have been transformation in the aspirations of women. The major contribution whenever feminist movement was evolving also belonged to the literature or literary figures, and the feminist literature was one area which was putting thrust on the movement for women's rights, and therefore we cannot ignore the contribution of feminist literature to the movement. For example, I would like to again bring you to Mary Wollstonecraft. Her book, A Vindication of the Rights of Women, written in 1972, is the most important contribution to women's literature. Then Simone de Beauvoir's book, The Second Sex, of 1979, it said liberation of women was liberation of men too, because women were looking after the family, and if they were educated, if they were emancipated, that means the entire family was emancipated. So she attributes that men can grow or men can get liberated only if the women were liberated. John Rawls, in his theory of justice, somewhat talks about women's equality, but he ignored women's position. He was not so vehemently talking about women's justice. For him, did not include very vehemently the women's position. Then Betty Friedan, she wrote The Feminine Mystique in 1963, and she attacked domesticity. She said that it is beyond the domestic arena that the women must move in order to evolve as charismatic personalities. The entire wave of the first, second, third wave, the growth of feminist literature, all these were aimed at some of the following things. They wanted to change the stereotype of women. They wanted to achieve economic and social independence for the women and to give them freedom in terms of choices, because the choices were widely available thanks to the Industrial Revolution, thanks to the development, thanks to globalization. So they had to have freedom of choice. Then throughout the movement, one common thread which was running, that women's perception as objects of desire had to be criticized. They were not mere objects of desire. They were more empowered. They were more substantial than only being objects of desire. And the other aim of the movement was to advance women's participation in political decision making and the areas of public life. They were given status, but whenever there was important decision making, it was a tendency to preclude the women. So this movement towards the end started saying that don't only give us positions, we want decision making powers also. We want to be part of the political decision making process, because till we find a place in the decision making, the interests of the women cannot be enhanced. This was the argument that women were taking. Now, if we look at the wave theory, there are certain criticisms of the wave theory. The wave theory ignores the resistance between 20s and 60s, because this was the period when I said the movement was waning because of the two world wars, and throughout history over male domination. So they say, they only talk about the women wanting to find a position, the women wanting to dominate, but they have never discussed that there were simultaneous movements by the male who wanted to suppress the women and dominate. It overlooks the resistance outside mainstream politics by women of color and working class. So whatever movements that have been covered during these waves or by the feminist literature were Eurocentric or they were US centric. They ignored the women, other movements or working class movements in the third world or developing countries, Africa and Asia. Now, so therefore, we come to the conclusion that it says this movement was confined to Europe and United States. Now, what were the other demands in the areas? For example, US, we know US and Europe, women were demanding voting rights. But what were the other demands in other parts of the world. Now, developing countries were wanting breaking away from the stereotype. The African women were demanding removal of bride price. The Muslim Middle East women wanted relaxation of dress code and seclusion. And most other countries were wanting to fight the system where women had to seek the permission of men to sign a contract or even bring about a simple lawsuit. Throughout this period, when we were talking about history, we are talking about the waves of feminist movement, there are certain approaches which become important. Now, if we look at the different approaches, the first approach is that gender differences are important and they must be fixed. This is called essentialism. The second approach is called the liberal feminist approach, which says that differences in abilities are trivial and therefore men and women are almost equal, and in women operating outside traditional gender roles must be the subject of study. And the third approach is postmodern feminism, where there are differences which are important, but these differences are arbitrary and flexible. If we look at some of the theories which have been prevalent, I'll just go briefly through these theories. If we look at some of the theories, there are liberal theories, radical theories, socialist and the Marxist theory, third world, then cultural feminism, post-colonial, eco-feminism. I will just briefly and quickly go through them. The liberal feminist theory defines a feminism in terms of two claims. One is the normative claim and the other is the descriptive claim. The normative claim says that women are equally entitled to rights and respects as the men are. And the descriptive discourse says that women are currently disadvantaged with respect to rights and respect if we compare them with men. So, normative is what ought to be, and descriptive, if we say, is what is the reality. Now, liberal philosophers or liberal theorists, they say that all people are created equal and they should not be denied equality of opportunity because of their gender. Now, liberal feminists, if we look at them, they focus all their efforts on constructions of legislations, because it is only through legislations that the status is going to change. Then the regulation in the employment practices also has to be gender neutral. This is liberal theorist. They want women to be treated equally with men. And Cynthia Enloe's contribution is very important. She has mostly looked at the role of women in the war scenario. And she says that their exclusion from the world politics is a natural consequence of their biological and or natural roles. And they have played a central role in combat always. And because they are the ones who have been acting as nurses or journalists, and they are the ones who have provided a safe and secure home to allow the men to be fighting without any problems or without any consideration of what is going on in their home front. Are their families, are they starving? So the women make sure that all these issues, trivial issues, don't bother men, and they can just go all out on the front and fight wars. The other theory, the stream, is called radical feminism. And it says, because it is a radical thinking, it says patriarchy has always oppressed women and it is the root cause of all other inequalities, because the women have been oppressed. Now, the radicalists also say that the differences have been on grounds of gender, on the grounds of race, the social class that women belong to, like the upper echelon, do not see that kind of discrimination as the lower strata faces, the perceived attractiveness of women. So women in amongst themselves then get divided on their physical attributes, their sexuality, etc. If you look at the socialist feminism, Marx is a major contributor. He said that when class oppression would be overcome, then gender oppression would automatically vanish. Now, some of these socialists were against this notion of Marx, and it said that you cannot subsume women's issues under broader class oppression, because this has to be treated separately and with care and with sensitivity, this issue has to be handled. Therefore, we see that in the Marxist view, we can say that there were two streams. One was the radical Marxist stream and the other was the socialist liberal stream. Now, if we look at Marx then, if we try to summarize how Marx looked at gender, Marx said that division of labor is related to gender role expectations. And he goes on to say that men are like bourgeois and women are like proletariat. So, in a way, he was trying to empower the women because he thought that men were the bourgeois who were exploiting the working class. Females, he defined the roles also. He said that females would give birth and males would be left to support families. Now, if we look at this recent concept which has emerged, which is called cultural feminism, it says that there are fundamental personality differences between men and women. And the differences between men and women gives women a special status, and this difference, which is special, must be celebrated. Because women are kinder and more gentle than men in outlook or in mentality. So, there is a general perception among the cultural feminists that if women rule the world, there would be no wars. So, if we want a peaceful world, the women should be handed over the reins of power. It believes the women's way is the better way of governance or polity or economic development. Now, if we look at the other stream, which is called the eco-feminist stream, it says that the patriarchy or the male ownership of land has led to a dominator culture. And this patriarchal ownership of land and other sources of resources has manifested itself in food insufficiency, in overgrazing, in the tragedy of the commons, in exploitation of resources. Everything, every ecological disaster, according to the eco-feminists, can be attributed to the patriarchal system of society. And the degradation of nature, because of the patriarchal hold, has led to the degradation of the women's status. This is eco-feminism. Now, in some of their current works, these eco-feminists even have gone on to argue that the capitalist and patriarchal system reveal a triple domination. Triple domination is domination of the global south, then domination of men over women, and domination of men over nature. So, this is the triple dominance that eco-feminists talk about. This male domination and exploitation of women are the core of the eco-feminist analysis. So, eco-feminists say that all resources, all environmental aspects, because of patriarchal control, have deteriorated, and this deterioration has led to men dominating over women. Now, if we look at the other stream or other thinking, this is called the third world feminism. The third world feminism developed in the third world countries. The white women were the dominant culture and they had the privilege of citizenship. So, the third world feminism basically criticizes the Western influence of Western feminism on the aspect of ignoring the race and culture of the non-Western places or areas. So, this we can say that this is, this third world feminism says that ethnocentrism is the one aspect which also divides the feminist group into the Western or developed world and the non-Western and the developing or the underdeveloped world. And throughout history of feminism, we have always ignored and never taken into account the unique experiences of the third world women. This is one of the criticisms or the cries of the women of the third world. Then comes the post-colonial feminism. It could be any of the above. It could be a liberalist group or socialist group. But the most important thing about post-colonial feminism is that it now starts talking about not only about social, political, economic aspects or empowerment of women, it goes beyond them and it starts speaking like black feminism or Africana feminism, Stevanism, Shikana feminism and femalism. So we have new concepts which emerge. Now, what are the present day demands of feminists? Now, if we have, when we have looked at all the theories, we know that the one important demand is that we do away with the inequality between man and women, man and woman. But what are the most important demands? And I would like now to come to the concluding part of the lecture by saying that the first and the foremost demand is change the stereotype role of women. And the second demand has been to make them economically and psychologically independent. So economic independence is not the only demand. Psychological independence is also what is required. The third demand would be broaden women's self-awareness and their opportunities. They should for themselves find out what is their capability, what is their potential, what are the opportunities that they have available, and then looking at their potential and the opportunities, then they must have the power to decision making so that they know what field is the best for them. And the last demand is, which is very important, because if till the time we advance women's participation in the political decision making, the interest of the women will not be defended. So having looked at all the concepts, all the waves of feminist theory, I would now like to come to the concluding part of the lecture. The first thing that I would say that throughout the lecture, one thing that emerged is that feminism, if we look at it, is a critique of patriarchy. So the feminist critique, if we say, is a critique of the patriarchal system of the society. Second thing we look at is that we were always looking at women's emancipation because they had always been denied public sphere. So we wanted the women to get emancipated. Then third thing is that the role of the women's NGOs became very important in making the women aware of their potential, of their abilities, of the opportunities available for them. No less important then was the decade for women, which gave us 10 years of dedicating policies and institutions and debates and discussions on women's aspects. Then we also said that there were different approaches which were now specially focusing on the role of gender and especially the female gender on development. So all these started highlighting the aspects of feminism. The female also started influencing through non-state channels like NGOs. As I said, there were certain violent movements which were being taken by women. There were civil society groups which were espousing the cause of women. Then, so the United Nations also tried to highlight that women were important contributors in the development of a country. Then we have to also, having looked at all these aspects, now we also have to look at the concept of globalization if we have to really say that how have women become important. Now, globalization has affected the women in the following ways. There have been cutback on social service, and so far all the welfare states had special schemes or special financial assistance for women. So now these social services were being cut down thanks to globalization. So women were in fact a little disturbed through the process of globalization. Then globalization also demanded that women's supporting state provisions should be removed. The one important aspect which maybe I will take up in a later lecture is a concept called feminization of poverty. So the poverty, the attribute or the reason for poverty was also feminine according to the patriarchal literature. Employment of cheap marginalized women force was increased by the MNCs because they were the ones who were not demanding many things, because they were happy that they were getting some opportunity. And so the terms and conditions of work atmosphere or work environment was not the one that they were exposing. And export of women became another important criteria. Therefore, having looked at all these concepts, we can easily say that it's not only about feminist movements of one country, another country, developed country, developed country, but what we can say, or what we can equally with emphatic emphasis say, that globalization has given one advantage, and then we are now talking about sisterhood of global women, and this is what is important. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, ma'am. Since we have a little bit of time, maybe I could ask you a few questions.
Yes, sure.
Which can also be probable questions arising in the minds of viewers. So, as you had already discussed, that although feminism was happening in Europe and America, it was of course taking place in other countries also, maybe not in such a large capacity. And would you say that we also have an indigenous tradition of feminism at the same time, and is there any record where one could go and read how feminism was traced within India?
Yes, as of indigenous feminist issues, for example, if we look at the Chipko movement, the Chipko movement was a creation of the women in Uttarakhand. Now, if we look at, I'll take you to another example in Brazil, which was also a developing country. The indigenous movement had a major role played by the women of the indigenous groups. For example, if we look at the present situation, the woman who represents the indigenous rights is a lady called Marina Silva, and she is one of the presidential candidates in the next year's, this year's election, 2014 election. So the indigenous people have been mostly involved in women's issue. You know, one, because ecofeminism, the concept that
right.
I said,
yes.
The women in the indigenous group especially, they believe that they are an intrinsic part of nature, and they are the ones who are taking out non-forestry products like leaves and fruits to fend for their families. So they have a sense of attachment and belonging. Okay,
right.
And all these contractors who come from outside, you know, the ladies don't come. So for the indigenous people, they feel that these are men who are trying to destroy the indigenous culture. So indigenous population, so women have been the most active defenders of these ecological rights, you know. So if we look at many of the Indian, even in India, as I told you, this was one example. If we look at many of the other areas, and specifically, I can't think of an example, but many of the indigenous groups, it was the women who were taking the lead in fighting the patriarchal society.
Right, ma'am, as you mentioned, in fact, Chipko movement also came in my mind. I recently read.
If you look at northeastern societies, you know, they are matrilineal societies.
Yes,
so the dominance of women force has been very important in the northeastern regions.
Yes. In fact, if we look at the Chipko movement, it shows that resistance can not only come by rich people or people in the West, but it's actually coming by very illiterate women who are forming groups and they're trying to protect their own environment. So it is not only that such movements originated in the West, but we have our own indigenous tradition of feminist movements.
Yes. You're very right, because we in India, we have n number of instances where women have been the protagonists. And
right, yes. Also, ma'am, I found, as you were talking, I found the use of the term gender equity very interesting. As it's already said, and women are also accepting their biological differences,
yes.
that they're physically weak, but they're not weak in other senses. So I thought that this term gender equity is very pertinent.
Because see,
yes.
if, for example, let's take the example of combat forces in the Indian Army, you know. So there are certain constraints which women have. For example, now if they have to be out for 15 days or 30 days, there are certain limitations which women biologically have. So giving them main force combat roles or putting them in fighter aircraft. So these are some of the things which we have, as of now, we haven't provided them. So
absolutely.
It's best to call it gender equity rather than
absolutely.
Equality.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you so much. So I'd like to share with all the viewers that in this lecture, we discussed the three waves of feminism, and in fact, in a very explicit manner, so that it becomes very easy to grasp. And along with that, we looked at different approaches such as liberal feminism, radical feminism, socialist feminism, cultural feminism, eco-feminism, third world feminism, post-colonial feminism, and we looked at the present day demands of women. We also looked at the views of certain philosophers such as Marx, Comte, Aristotle, Plato, amongst many. And as we wind up this lecture, I would like to thank ma'am for being here. It was absolute pleasure to have you here, and complete delight to hear her talking, and I hope that we have her on more occasions. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.